Good morning. My name is Jason Norsworthy, and I'm Distinguished Professor of Weed Science within the Crop, Soil, and Environmental Science Department. And this morning, for the Rice Field Day, I'm joined by Dr. Tommy Butts, who is an assistant professor and also our extension weed scientist within the Crop, Soil, and Environmental Science Department. Good morning, Tommy. And hey, I see here at the field day that you brought brought some sedges here. Tell us a little bit about the sedges that you brought.
Definitely. So the past couple of years, phone calls and everything has gone through the roof on sedge control and identifying sedges. And so I was able to visit a couple fields here in the past couple of weeks and get some examples of four different sedge species that we're really battling out there in our rice acres. And so I wanted to bring them in to highlight some identification differences, and then we'll chat about the control efforts for these different sedges. So the first one I want to talk about is right here, right in front of me. This is actually yellow nut sedge. So very common across our landscape. One of the first things that always helps me identify yellow nut sedge is really the pattern that you see across the field. With a lot of our other sedges, they typically can be pretty widespread, uniform, almost like a blanket. Yellow nut sedge always tends to be very patchy or clumpy. You end up with little spots, well, not necessarily little, but spots throughout the field. They're not kind of as uniform as some of these other sedge species. A couple other identification characteristics. It tends to have a light green, almost yellow color to it, a very prominent mid vein that runs through that leaf blade, as well as a real, real waxy leaf surface, almost waxier than a lot of our other sedges as well. And then one of the final distinguishing characteristics that helps with yellow compared to our other sedges is if you dig up the roots, you know, sometimes you can be able to find that little nutlet or tuber, and that can range in size. Normally when I found them, they're around like a penny size. Also, if you have a bad yellow nut sedge problem and you are walking through a flooded field, normally you can see those nutlets floating on the water surface. So that helps kind of give that away a little bit too. But if you can't find a nutlet, the other thing that you can look for when you dig up the roots are the rhizomes. And that's an example of that rhizome right there. Yellow nut sedge can reproduce from seed, but the vast majority of our problems come from those rhizomes getting spread across the field or those nutlets getting spread across the field. And so that's a great way to identify yellow nut sedge compared to a lot of our other problematic sedge species that we have out there.
Hey, one just comment on that, Tommy, is that, you know, the plant that you've got in front of you is about 8 to 10 inches tall, and we look at these other sedges over here that you'll talk about in a moment, and right now, someone that's viewing this may sit here and say, well, that's a relatively small sedge versus these others, and what just comment on that.
And that's definitely not true. So this was just the samples that I was able to collect. This is the stages they were at. Yellow nut sedge actually can get quite big. I mean, I would compare it to our sedge sample that we have here. It can get up, you know, quite large. The other two that we're talking about, the rice flat sedge and small flower umbrella sedge, tend to be a little bit smaller than yellow nut sedge when they're full grown, all headed out and everything like that. So this is just kind of a vegetative example because it's what I have, but it can get much larger. Absolutely. Throughout the season. So the second sedge sample that I wanted to talk about is actually over here on this side, and this happens to be rice flat sedge. And I just want to pull one out quick. So rice flat sedge is also very common across the landscape, also very challenging to control, which we'll talk about in a second. But ALS inhibitor resistance is so widespread in rice flat sedge anymore that I really don't even talk about ALS inhibitors for control anymore. I try and focus on other efforts there. One of the best indicators for rice flat sedge is always, even when they're small, is to pick the plant out of the ground and crush it up in your hands and then smell it. Can you all smell that? Oh, that's right, video. Forgot. We don't have smell-o-vision anymore. But the rice flat sedge plants will have a really strong cedar, Christmas tree type smell. It's very different than a lot of our other sedges. If you crush one of the other sedges, it just smells like green plant material, whereas this has that real strong cedar Christmas tree smell.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So that's, to me, that's always the best indicator to get rice flat sedge, even when it's small. You crush it, it has that smell, boom, that's the weed it is, the sedge species that it is.
Hey, so you said ALS herbicides here. So again, for those viewing this, ALS herbicides, we're talking things like Permit mm-hmm. Plus, Gambit,
Grasp,
absolutely. Yeah. Those herbicides really are not going to be effective here. And I guess while we're on this before we move on is, let's just talk about some solutions to this problem, because I agree with you. I mean, I'd say today that we're probably north of 50%, 60-70% of the rice flat sedge we see in Arkansas now is ALS resistant. So when I take a look at this weed here, for me, It's something like a loyant. 8 ounces of loyant has looked very good in my research.
Especially when it's small. If you're at like six inches, that 8 ounce rate is great. Once it gets bigger I want it, absolutely.
I start going, once it gets above 6 inches, 10, 12, yes. etc. in yep. terms of the use rates. Another thing here is propanil bassegran yes. has looked very good for me in my my research. And I really say propanil plus bassegran. Propanil has some activity, bassegran has some activity, but when I mix those two together, it looks really good. But one thing that's interesting, Tommy, is when I look in this, I'm look here and I start pulling in your sample here, you actually have some grass. And one of the biggest issues that I run into when I'm talking about a sedge, like rice flat sedge, nut sedge, etc., is propanil bassegran. If a grower's going to use those, they're also trying to generally kill some grass in that field, barnyard grass, broadleaf signal grass, et cetera. And you can see antagonism when you put those together. Actually, I had a call the other day, just a few weeks ago, when I was talking to a grower, and he made the comment that he had actually gone after some barnyard grass and had waited 24 hours, 48 hours in terms of coming back with some propanil bassegran to control this weed. And he actually had skipped an area in the field and saw some antagonism where he had actually sprayed those. So what's just your thoughts on that?
Well, 100% I agree. I've had some, numerous conversations with consultants and things about battling sedges and grasses at the same time in the field. And it's come down to the point where, even in my samples that I collected, I couldn't get the grasses out and sedges, separated. And it's come to the point where we have to have the conversation. If we're gonna try and save ourselves a pass and we're gonna make these tank mixes, we probably need to expect some antagonism and some loss in control. The best case scenario is that we're able to split out applications and, especially separate them by more than 24 hours. A few days difference is really needed, but separate those applications out where we can really target sedge in one and grass in another. That's also challenging because then our sizes, start getting out of hand. We're not as timely anymore on that fashion. When we talked about rice flat sedge, we mentioned loyant is a very good option, and loyant with some of those other grass herbicides is actually really good tank mix partners.
Absolutely.
Now, we can't mix loyant and regiment, which is one downside. That's not labeled yet, but a loyant and clincher option is really good, and it helps get both grasses and sedges.
Now, but again, there's the airplane.
Exactly.
Issue.
Now, there's other applications issues and drift issues and things like that. And I know there's concerns about ever getting it out. But again, it comes back to we have to make a decision on what we want. That's our best tank mix to get control. So if you absolutely need control, best option there, find a way to get that out. If not, if we're going to tank mix them, expect some antagonism. And if not there, if you can do the sequentials and still be timely with things, then that's really another option there.
And again, we're going to get to these other sedges, but while I'm right here, another option that I like is impregnating loyant with on urea.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden I drop that into the flood and then possibly come back in and try to clean up some grasses if I've got some large grasses that time. And so with that, you've separated those. You don't have the off-target movement issue that you generally have with a spray application. Of course, our guys that are in fur irrigated rice, those acres are growing. They're applying it with a ground rig and there appears to be a lot less risk. Yeah. We've done some work on that, a lot less risk for that off-target movement with that ground rig versus aerial application.
When we did the loyant drift out of a ground rig versus a plane, it's normally anywhere between like a 3 and 10-fold difference there in drift downwind. So the ground rig, anywhere between 3 and 10-fold less drift downwind than out of our airplanes. And so that's a big benefit if we can get out there with the ground rigs for sure.
The one thing that we have seen though is you've got to be somewhere around 150 pounds of urea or more if you're going to put this out. You start running 16 ounces of loyant on 100 pounds of urea, you just got too much liquid you're putting on that urea and it has a tendency to solidify,
gum up some.
And so we've had some issues with that. Yeah. We want to make sure we're at some higher rates of urea if that's what we're going to do. But that's one way of kind of getting around this problem.
Awesome. Well, so that was rice flat sedge. The next one I wanted to jump to was right here. This is actually small flower umbrella sedge. Now I'd say this, out of the four species that we have up here, I almost think small flower umbrella is now our fourth least common that we have out there, but it is still fairly prevalent. You can notice once it flowers and you have that seed head on there, it's a very different look compared to our other sedges. There's these small little clusters of seeds that develop in these almost little spherical balls. When it's smaller, it's a little bit more tougher to distinguish between these other sedges, but it normally is a finer type sedge. The leaf is a little bit narrower. When it's real small, it almost forms like a V pattern with needle-like leaves. So just kind of an all-around finer sedge. It doesn't just quite look the same as like our rice flat sedge, yellow nut sedge, or our white margined flat sedge. This one, as far as control methods go, really we moved these three to the end versus yellow nut sedge because these three are very similar in control. So we talked about the loyant, we talked about the bascaran and propanil. Those would be the options that you want to use on the small flower umbrella sedge as well. The final one that I wanted to show, and this one is, it's not necessarily relatively new, but it seems like it's making its way across the state a lot more, and there's a lot more people IDing it, and so we kind of wanted to show an example for people out there. This happens to be the white margined flat sedge that I've talked about now for a couple years. As you can see, just compared to these other four right next door, it has that much whiter silver appearance to it. And if you happen to get up close and you look at both the top and the bottom side of the leaves, there's a real white silver color to it, but the mid vein is always still green. So you'll have a deep, dark green mid vein, but then the leaf around it is basically completely white or silver. Also, when it gets to be this big, the base of the plant almost tends to lose its triangle shape. It's almost a round base now at this point, and it's real fleshy, waterlogged feeling. Also, if we dig up the roots, it tends to have a real bright red root system. So again, all of these kind of indicate that it's a white margin flat sedge versus some of these others. When it's small, the plant that I think it looks the most like is rice flat sedge. So it can be really difficult when we're talking, you know, 4 inches or so to distinguish those two apart. But again, we already mentioned if you pull up a plant, crush it, and smell it, and you can have that cedar smell, it's rice flat sedge. White margin flat sedge won't have that smell. And so if you pull it up, it doesn't have a smell. Normally, it gears towards this white margin flat sedge more or less. And again, I have it in this grouping. In some of my screenings that I've done on it, the loyant, the propanil, and bascaran, those have been the best options to help manage this one. And honestly, 2,4-D can be an option in certain areas too. 2,4-D has done fairly decently on white margin. It can help on the rice flat sedge, those kinds of things. 2,4-D is not necessarily a home run, but if you're looking for something to help, it can definitely help in situations where it's still able to be applied.
Hey Tommy, another one that on this small flower umbrella sedge as well as on this rice flat sedge that has really looked good in my plots, as well as I saw some success in grower fields this year, is the use of Rogue.
Yes.
Okay, so you know we were able to get a section 18 for Rogue this year. I've heard nothing but positives associated with that. I spoke to Gowan a couple of days ago. They're expecting in September a PREA date for registration of the herbicide, so hopefully next year we'll have a section 3 if that comes in September, and we will not be under a section 18. But it is one of the most effective post-flood options that I have ever seen for the use of trying to control these. But now with that, when I look at Rogue, I tell folks that Rogue is not for everyone.
Yes.
Rogue is really for that guy that is able to pump up a deep flood. When I say a deep flood, 4, 5, 6 inches, the deeper you can get it, the better off you are. You've got to be able to hold your water. Mm-hmm. And this is really the strength of that program. It's really some of these sedges. It's also the
Spranglethop.
Spranglethop.
I was just
going to
mention that, actually. This year, I don't know what it is about this year, but when I've been driving around the countryside, it seems like Spranglethop has blown through a lot of fields. And so having Rogue, not only for the sedge control, but the Spranglethop control. And again, we talked about trying to manage grasses and sedges can be real difficult in the same field. Having that option post-flood to knock out that Spranglethop, knock out the sedges would be really awesome. And it has been really awesome for the growers that's been on with the Section 18 this year.
But that guy that's on a field with a tremendous grade, a lot of gates in the field, that is not the guy that needs to be out there applying Rogue.
You really want a straight levied or a zero grade field.
Absolutely. You know? We want to be able to hold the water. So in addition to that,
I was going to say the one final thing on the sedges before we kind of jump to, I don't think we mentioned control methods for yellow nut sedge. So we mentioned these three were kind of, you know, separate on this side of the table, loyant, propanil, bascaran, maybe 2,4-D, Rogue, those kinds of things. When we get to yellow nut sedge, this one is all off on its own, separate from everybody else. Really about the only super successful option to manage yellow nut sedge is going back to our ALS inhibitors that we already talked about, like Permit, Permit Plus, Gambit, those kinds of things. Those are the best options to manage this. Now, bascaran and propanil, you know, can work on it, but you normally need sequentials and you may or may not completely kill it. Loyant can help, but again, it's not a home run like it is with these sedges. And so really, if we have this one in our field, we really want to go that ALS route, the permit plus gambit. And so it becomes very important, especially to distinguish yellow nut sedge from our other sedges, because it's completely different control methods considering all the ALS inhibitor resistance we have on this end of the table.
But I have seen and confirmed some populations of ALS resistant yellow nut sedge. It's not like what we have with the rice flat sedge, with the umbrella sedge, but we do have some locations within the state. And you know, where we do have confirmed ALS resistance, I really think you're back to that propanil bassegrain. And you're right, it may take multiple applications. Part of that's contingent upon size.
Yeah.
If it's small, I have had some success getting it with one application. As it starts getting some size to it, I would tell you overall, if I do not have use of the ALS herbicides, I'm probably going to look at a propanil bassegrain, make an application, evaluate the success of that application, and if I need to, come back with another application of that. And I know that's an expensive treatment, but that's where we are.
Do you just want to hit on Rogue? So we talked about Rogue down there.
Absolutely. So we did mention Rogue, and you know, the funny thing is Rogue is one of the better herbicides I've ever seen in terms of, I said, the small flower umbrella sedge, and I also mentioned, again, the rice flat sedge. I do not consider Rogue to be an effective option for yellow nut sedge. You know, I can get a little bit of activity out of it. I'll see some whitening of a yellow nut sedge plant, but in terms of effective control, it is really not where we want to be.
Well, perfect. I think that's kind of what we wanted to hit on the sedge front. I know we got a couple other topics.
Yeah, so in addition to that, you know, I'm really excited. You know, this past summer here, we're looking at some of the rice plots that we've got out here. We've actually evaluated 7 new herbicides that are not registered in rice. So, you know, being an individual that works in cotton, corn, soybean, rice, etc., there is more chemistry that is coming or is being evaluated in rice than in any other crop.
Well, that's good news.
I'll tell you what, that's exciting. Yeah. When we really think about the problems what we have, and one herbicide that I had an opportunity to look at this year is the new compound that is coming from FMC, and it's a new mode of action. I'm not going to give you the name of it today, but it is a...
Neither one of us can pronounce it, that's why.
So. It's a new mode of action, and really, if you think back in terms of modes of action, the last time a mode of action was discovered and commercialized, we're talking the HPPD chemistry, and that would have been back, in terms of discovery, early 80s.
Before I was born.
Early 80s is when that would have actually been discovered. So I am just excited. We're talking about a Weed Science Society of America Group 28 herbicide. Really, looking at the symptomology in the field, it's extremely novel in terms of how it behaves on weeds. I've got some plots back here behind me. When we look at this rice back here, you can see, I mean, very, very effective in terms of weed control in this rice.
And on our most problematic weed, the
most problematic weeds is what we're seeing here. And so then really also is when you take a look at this herbicide, we're talking 2025 is what FMC is telling me that they're probably going to have a registration of this. And I'm also being told that they're going to pursue it in addition to rice. Soybean is probably going to be another crop that they're going to have some interest in terms of pursuing it. But I'm really, really excited when I see the performance of this herbicide. And I'll say it is a very, very effective herbicide on some of the target species that we deal with. So in addition to that, another tool that we have that's coming, kind of adding to our portfolio, we've got Provisia rice today, but you know, Max Ace rice is coming, and we continue to evaluate that. And it looks
and Max Ace is the same herbicide tolerance as Provisia.
Absolutely.
It's just Rice Tech
is going to produce that, but now Rice Tech does not have import approval in Canada as of today for that. So until we get import approval, we're not going to have commercial use of Max Ace rice. But I really like that technology.
Is it looking like next year, maybe?
I'm thinking that possibly it is. I'm hearing that, again, just as soon as Canada pulls the trigger and approves that, that we will have it commercial. And, you know, I've really been impressed with the yield potential of of their germplasm. You know, some of the inbred stuff has been cutting in my plots 190, 195. Mm-hmm. I know they've got some hybrids that's also coming. That's a little bit different from a herbicide standpoint than what we see with Provisia, because they have a safener with theirs, where Provisia herbicide, the high card, is going to have a safener. Yeah. Provisia does not have a safener. And so what I've seen with that is, The activity is a little bit slower than what we get with Provisia herbicide. It is a very effective system for barnyard grass and for weedy rice, but in my work, we really have to have two applications of the high card if I'm going to achieve a high level of control. Otherwise, just one application. I've had a good many misses with one application.
So just to stress that difference again too, it's kind of going to be like the full page clear field system. So we've got Max Ace and Provisia now. On the Provisia rice, we'll have Provisia herbicide that is an unsafe inversion of that Quizalofop, but the Provisia is able to handle it and it does an excellent job on our weed control front. With the Max Ace rice, it'll be labeled that we spray high card, and high card has that safener in it. So it's a little bit safer, you know, for that, that Max Ace hybrids and variety. We do lose a little bit though on that weed control front, and so it, like we've mentioned with our trials, we really need that sequential at full rates to make sure we're still maximizing that control.
Legally, you cannot spray Provisia on Max Ace rice, and you don't want to spray Provisium Max Ace. If you spray Provisium Max Ace rice, you're going to not like what you see from a tolerance standpoint. So really we need that safener in there. So another product that's received registration this year is Novixit. It's a Corteva product. It's got, it's basically a combo. It's a combo of loyant plus grasp. Yep. And, you know, I think that has opened some doors for us from the standpoint of some residual grass control that we can get with that product. I really like it in row rice. I think it does have some fit in flooded rice also. It's looked real good in my plots.
And depending on resistances, like we talked about, it may help us with the sedge and grass control type thing. Again, we talked about earlier, you can get a little bit of grass control from the grass, maybe from the loyant as well, and then you're getting sedges with the loyant too.
Exactly. So another thing that I saw in my plots this year, we've kind of stepped back and we've revisited some work with Rice Star. You know, Gowan now has Rice Star, and historically we've thought of Rice Star as being a pre-flood or a post-flood, I'd call it a salvage herbicide. Yep. And you know, this year we put a lot of effort into going back in and making timely applications, I'm gonna say early post, on the use of Rice Star. You know, I was walking some of my plots yesterday. Here we are late in the season. My rice has headed in some of the plots I was walking. And you know, where I had actually used Rice Star early post, I had complete control of barnyard grass. Where we went and actually took Rice Star and used it pre-flood, used it post-flood kind of as a salvage treatment, had a lot of barnyard grass still out there. Now, granted, I killed a lot of barnyard grass with that treatment, but I really think we would be a lot better off if we would try to put that a little earlier. And I know folks say, well, you know, I don't want to put it on dry ground, I want moisture. And I think to some extent we probably have overemphasized the need for moisture. I think putting it on dry soil where I've got small barnyard grass, one leaf, two leaf, you're going to get a lot better result than you are out there on a four leaf, five leaf, six leaf tillering barnyard grass in terms of performance.
Well, and we kind of always, you know, we talk about the moisture aspect, but we always kind of forget about the temperature aspect too.
Absolutely.
And if we're earlier in the season, we got just a little bit, you know, lower temperatures, that it makes those work a little bit better too than if we're 90, 95 plus.
That,
and
that is a herbicide.
Well,
when we start getting in those 90, 95 degree temps, that herbicide has a tendency not to perform as well on some of these grass species with that.
The other thing with Rice Star that I like moving it up to that early post timing too, and not that this is very common, you know, not that we'll flash a lot of injury from Rice Star at times, but it, the more we can get it away from that pre-flood and we hammer it with fertilizer immediately and then hammer it with the flood immediately, we avoid any potential kind of injury coming out of that Rice Star product. You know, if we applied at that pre-flood timing, fertilize it immediately, flood it immediately, we have flashed some injury in some areas. And not that it kills the rice necessarily, but it might kill off one tiller and it might set it back some, which is never good to see either. So if we can move it up in that early post time, we effectively remove that crop injury potential as well.
Exactly. Another issue that I heard this year is, you know, as we've moved more and more to row rice, and then also as we've got our dicamba in soybeans and in cotton, you know, I've talked to some folks and said, well, you know, I've just taken my burn down and I had dicamba in my burn down for some other crops and I've just kind of moved that over into rice. And you know, that's not a labeled application, and we went and did some work with it this year, and I really didn't expect to see a lot of injury. But when we went in and we took dicamba as well as 2,4-D, and we took and we actually applied those at planting, we saw a major reduction in emergence. I'm going to say probably 50-60% at least initial emergence reduction. We also saw a delay in the emergence of that rice, and just want to point out that I'm not saying that you can't survive that, but that was not something that I think we want to be out there recommending or doing.
And I know Dr. Tom Barber repeated those studies at well at different locations, and he saw the same results. I mean, it was multiple locations, you know, multiple different soil types, all kinds of different things, and it happened basically at every site. We saw pretty
Absolutely.
Significant stand reduction.
I had multiple sites and saw it at both sites. And so as we begin to close today, one thing is I do want to, we talked about resist today. We talked about these sedges. We always talk about barnyard grass and the herbicide resistant screening program that we have. And you know, I sent you the form yesterday.
Yes.
We're going to send the form out, the herbicide resistant screening form out to all the county agents here in the coming days. And it's about that time of year where we start collecting sedges, barnyard grass, plants that we have concern with. And I have a resistant screening program that I'll run those through during the winter months. And at least for barnyard grass, we're going to screen against 7 different herbicides. We're going to get those results back to the growers, hopefully late February, so they can make an informed decision as how to put together a program. And I would just tell you that when you're collecting those samples, we need 25 to 30 seed heads, at least for barnyard grass. We want to have a mature seed sample. The biggest problem that I have, regardless of what the weed species is, that I have growers or consultants have a tendency to harvest those plants a little early.
Yeah.
And if I can't get them to germinate, I'm not able to evaluate them. So make use of that program. That's a program that is funded, or at least partially funded, by the Arkansas Rice Research and Promotion Board. And with that, I think that is a valuable tool that growers can use, not only to understand what they have resistance to, but also understand what works in terms of putting together a program. So with that, again, I would just like to say as we close here now, we appreciate the Arkansas Rice Research and Promotion Board, the funding that they provide, the opportunities that we have to try to bring solutions to you, the grower in rice. And Tommy, again, I really appreciate you being with us this morning to talk about kind of our research and what we've seen this year.
So, thank you for having me, and a couple other big thank yous that we wanted to hit on too. You know, thank you to our teams for managing a lot of our research trials and things. We wouldn't be able to do any of this without them, so thank you to them. And thank you to you, the viewer, for watching and continuing to support the University of Arkansas System Division of Agriculture. So thank you very much. I'm good unless you got anything else.
Thanks a lot.
Yeah.
Appreciate you.
Thank you.